Ghostbusters, Bill Murray, because he's so sexy.
Dan Aykroyd.
Harold Ramis.
I love them all.
I ain't afraid of no ghosts.
Well, welcome to the wonderful world of Ghostbusters.
Director Ivan Reitman has reunited the team of cutting-edge comic actors and writers who made Ghostbusters the highest-grossing film comedy ever. They're together again to save the day in Ghostbusters 2.
We're ready for it. We're ready for it.
Yeah.
Actually, we never thought we would make a sequel. But as we thought about the experience and as the sort of the phenomena started taking hold, then the possibility that became the probability of a sequel grew.
Ivan Reitman, Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Harold Ramis, and Rick Moranis have been setting new standards in comedy for nearly two decades. But when they came together in Ghostbusters, they created a phenomenon that took them and the whole world by surprise.
Ghostbusters! There's something strange in your neighborhood. Who you gonna call?
I'm amazed at how long it's been popular. I mean, normally you do a film and it's out for 6 months if you're lucky and people are still talking about it, and then it's gone.
None of us had ever done a sequel, although we had offers on virtually every film we'd worked on.
There's definitely something going on in that studio. The PKE levels were just out of sight.
But then we started thinking, well, if we could come up with a concept that seemed worthy, that really progressed us in some way, that had something new to say, then we could, let's do it.
I always knew that there was more than one story. Even when writing the first one, I was thinking of, well, if they do this, they could do this, this, and this.
Go ahead, Ray.
You foul, obnoxious moth!
I'm a weak electrochemical bond!
I have seen some disgusting crud in my time, but you take the case! You're just...
This is what you do with your spare time.
The first one, I ended up with all the lines, so that was pretty sweet. They just kept giving them to me. I don't think they realized what a big hit the movie was going to be, but this one, people are taking the lines that are theirs and taking more, too.
Part of the success of the first film was the friendliness of the characters to the audience and back. You know, I think they responded to the four Ghostbusters and to the other characters in the film.
Born to wear this stuff.
Everybody's back. I think it's unbelievable. I mean, the sequels never get the whole original cast back, I don't think.
It's very much like coming back to family. I'm walking around here saying, let's do a series. You know, Thursday nights at 9:30, Ghostbusters. What? You know, this is it.
Two in the box!
Ready to go!
We be fast and
they be slow!
Wow!
To me, it's like being put in a class with the most awful boys who spend all their time throwing spitballs and dipping your braids into the inkwell. You know, it's this sort of streak of masochism in me. I mean, I love them all, but it really is like Boys Town.
Go! No, please go! You!
Who's this wiggler?
He's yours, Ray. Sick him.
There are some additions to this exceptional cast. Peter McNichol is Dana's boss, Janos Poha. And William and Henry Deutschendorf make their screen debuts as Oscar, son of the now-divorced Dana.
I think one of the big changes in this is the little child that I have. I actually think Bill is so wonderful with kids. You know, he charms children right away, even babies.
Well, what do you think?
He's ugly. I mean, he's not Elephant Man ugly, but... he's not attractive. Was his father ugly?
Don't listen.
When Ghostbusters 2 hit the streets last December, these notoriously blasé New Yorkers embraced them.
How many people are from out of town? Can we hear from you folks?
Yeah!
How many people from New York City? Can we hear from you folks? What do you say we just beat the hell out of the tourists, huh?
There's not a cold heart in the crowd.
Since New York itself is an important character in the story, production designer Bo Welch did extensive research on the city's architectural history to create the look of the film. Once production in New York was completed, the cast and crew moved to Los Angeles for more location shooting and eventually wound up occupying several sound stages at Columbia Pictures.
Roll slate.
Meanwhile, in Northern California, those techno wizards at Industrial Light and Magic were busy creating new and improved ghosts, and good slime and bad slime.
We didn't think this would happen, but there is more slime in this movie. Slime is very central to it.
Too much slime. We shot a scene last night where we were doused continuously in slime.
As a director, it's an extraordinary thrill because it means that somehow, in the process of the storytelling, I'm communicating to a very broad audience. And it's not only in America, it's universal across the world.
We're the best, we're the beautiful, we're the only Ghostbusters.
Afraid of no ghosts.
In Ghostbusters, Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Harold Ramis, Ernie Hudson, and director Ivan Reitman created a comic chemistry that was box office magic.
We're the best, we're the beautiful, we're the only Ghostbusters.
Murray, Aykroyd, and Ramis have known each other for years and have worked on many successful projects together. And they all have roots in the Second City Theater, a company that stresses sharing the spotlight rather than competing for it.
We work as a group very well because we learned in the Second City Theater to, you know, if you make the other people look good, you'll look good.
Yeah, we talk in shorthand. We understand each other.
Let's go, guys. Let's go. Be marker.
We understand the techniques of Second City and the idea of developing a story from nothing.
Thanks, appreciate it. Thanks for holding here. Are you down in there or what?
Hey, relax, you're on the meter.
Come on, hey, we're scientists, get out of the way.
Someone asked me if I was the class clown. I said I wasn't, but I used to write for the class clown. And that sort of was true. I would instigate practical jokes or suggest things. I would say something quietly, which the someone else would then repeat louder and get the laugh, you know, and I thought, well, gee, you know, he got the laugh, I wrote the line.
Get your off!
Hey, go! Hey, he's gone!
Get
off! Hey, whoa, whoa, wait.
We find so much in the rehearsals.
You basically are trying to keep the ball up in the air.
We change lines and are able to really discover beats and things that don't jump out off the page at you.
If I don't have the idea, somebody else tries to whack it up there. Just keep it up somehow so you can see it.
We've developed a pretty good collaborative sense, I think. God, I haven't had one of these on in years.
What am I doing? Why am I going along with this?
No, this I don't mind. Slime of mine.
The thing that I found interesting about Bill and Danny and Harold, even though they're big stars, they really are there 100%. They're real troopers, and it's hard not to be a real trooper when they are.
Would you like to see something really special? No, I mean really special. Ready? On the count of three, one, two, three. Would you mind circulating through the crowd, just showing everybody up close and personal? Look at this, don't be frightened. It's a human mouth.
That's the deal, is you just keep looking for what makes you laugh. I mean, if I knew, then I'd always be funny, you know? I mean, I'd always be laughing, but I'm not always laughing and I'm not always funny. And that's what I guess gets you out of bed in the morning is what's gonna be funny today.
Two in the box!
Ready to go.
We be fast and
they be slow.
This hole, the hole that they're going in is really only about 3 feet deep. There's not enough room for one guy, and we're sort of cramming three of them in there. That's the kind of director I am.
He's the kind of director who will stop at nothing when it comes to making people laugh.
Stand by, let's cut. Let's go down again.
He's Ivan Reitman, director of Ghostbusters, Twins, Stripes, Meatballs, and now Ghostbusters 2.
For a director, the tough part here is to recapture the electricity that came about from the first one. The job has been made easier for me because of the excellence of the performers. I mean, there is something that happens when you put these guys together in a room.
Ah! Ow! Ow! How did you ever go for it? The old man-eating toaster.
They're individually wonderful actors and comedians, and somehow when they work together, they're even greater than the sum of the parts. It really needs a double take.
I really like working with Ivan. I think he works with actors very well, and we need him in a film like this because we need him to say, this should be real, this should be funny, you know, we need him to sort of be our compass sometimes, because sometimes you really don't know.
So how are we going to handle the sleeping arrangements?
Well, what's best for me is if I lie on my side like this and you spoon up beside me, your arm draped over me.
Sometimes we shoot the whole first master scene and we shoot somebody's close-up and somebody else's close-up, and then all of a sudden you find something for someone and they gotta turn the camera around because you found more. You know, you gotta turn the camera back around and get this again because you found more. You know, that's, you know, some directors would never do that. Ivan's always done it because he goes, I need that, I want that, turn it around and we get it.
Pretty cheap laugh. Bill always kids me on what an easy laugh I am, but I feel that the actors feel it, that at some point they have to focus on somebody. They have to get an energy, so I give it. When I get what I want, I'll often say to the actors, I've got what I want, we can go to the next shot, but how about, I'm gonna give you one for free, do whatever you want, go for it. And I found that that's a very freeing process to both sides, and often the best take occurs at that point.
Are you the Keymaster?
When director Ivan Reitman was looking for an actress to play Dana Barrett in the first Ghostbusters movie,
first of all, they didn't want to see me.
You look at it like that, which is good, but now, yeah, bring her over. So you're facing...
I think it's sort of like Sigourney Weaver, but she's so serious. And then the fact that they kept making me audition and everything, so I really became very determined to show them that I could do this.
That was 5 years ago. Since then, she has won 2 Golden Globe Awards and 3 Oscar nominations for her performances in Aliens, Working Girl, and Gorillas in the Mist. Now she's back in Ghostbusters 2 with the rest of the gang, plus a bare-bottomed edition.
I love children, and one of the reasons I wanted to play Dana was that she is a mother and clearly gets so much joy out of her child, and it becomes the heart stone of the piece that her baby's in danger.
That's my baby! Watch out!
Part of the attraction to do this one and the first one was to work with these guys, because they had such an interesting track history.
Well, I know I'm just asking for the big hurt, but I thought I'd give us one more chance. He tortured me. He pulled my ears.
Hello, Peter.
Hello, Dana.
They will just tease me to death if I bring up anything like motivation or anything, but I'm used to that, and I think it's been very good for me. I asked Bill early on what he thought of the arc of our relationship, and you know, for days afterward, every time he saw me, he'd say, the arc, right? The arc. You want to know about the arc?
You're good, pretty eyes.
It's actually really nice to be the Margaret Dumont of this particular group. I feel actually that it's a great honor and privilege. I feel they are our sort of Marx Brothers.
Dana, the guys are going down into the sewer to check for slime stuff, and Egon thinks there may be a huge surge in cockroach breeding. You want to blow off this dinner thing and go with them?
Taxi!
women.
Huh? When the Ghostbusters set up shop again, they quickly find themselves in need of a lawyer.
I think you guys are making a big mistake. I do mostly tax law and some probate stuff occasionally. I got my law degree in night school.
They also rehire their super secretary, Janine.
Ghostbusters.
Rick Moranis and Annie Potts.
Yes, we're back.
In Ghostbusters 2.
I'm just as thrilled as you are.
And they're not just back, they're together.
Well, this time I'm trying to get it on with the terror dog. It's Rick and I are kind of have a romance.
I think motherhood's a very natural instinct. I like a child myself. Would you?
Tonight?
Lewis is a broad character. I mean, look at this. These are not my own clothes. Though I will be keeping them after the film. I keep all of Lewis's clothes.
Rick Moranis has portrayed comic roles in such films as Spaceballs and Little Shop of Horrors. But it was as one of the creators of the popular Canadian series SCTV that he developed an approach to comedy much like that of Ivan Reitman, the director of Ghostbusters 2.
Ivan Reitman's style is to hire people that are really good on their feet, that have a writing background, and the script is really a blueprint, and at the beginning of each session of shooting, we go over it and we change it and we try and come up with good things that make us all happy. And that's the way we work.
Should I just take a and then go?
Well. And he ultimately is the one who decides, which is good because as an actor, you don't want to have to make that decision.
Well, how's Oscar? Is he all right?
Oh, he's fine. Such a good baby. He was a little fussy at first, then we just gave him some French bed pizza. Passed right out.
Annie Potts is no stranger to series television either. She stars as Mary Jo Shively in the comedy hit Designing Women. But unlike Moranis, she relies more on the script than improvisation.
In the middle of...
I was just trying to get that green stinky thing.
Harold and Danny wrote this very funny character, and they wrote her very well, so I don't feel like I need to go off or anything. I mean, occasionally there'll be, you know, a little twist here or there, and that's fine.
While Rick Moranis and Annie Potts arrive at comedy from two totally different directions, they are both still grappling with that all-important question. What makes good comedy?
It's such an ephemeral thing.
The misfortunes of others.
A baby when they first learn humor.
The unexpected makes me laugh.
Boo. That's funny.
You look fantastic in this.
I was born to wear this stuff.
And it's great to write lines. You come up with a line for somebody else. There's four, you know, we're all writing all the time when we're working. It keeps you fresh, keeps you alive, keeps you aware. And, you know, I'll write a line and say, here, Dan, you take it. You go, no, you take it, you know, or write a line, Harold will write a line for me and I'll give it to Dan, or I'll write a line, you know, Dan will write a line for me and I'll give it to Harold, or, you know. The first one, I ended up with all the lines, so that was pretty sweet. They just kept giving them to me. I don't think they realized what a big hit the movie was going to be, but this one, people are taking the lines that are theirs and taking more too. But so it's going to be more spread out, but the lines are still going to be very funny. When in a group like that, a dynamic, you basically are trying to keep the ball up in the air. You know, you're trying to keep it up, so. If I don't have the idea, somebody else tries to whack it up there. Just keep it up somehow so you can see it. You know, you can figure out what it is. You just keep it up. Keeping the plate spinning is another way of saying it, you know. If that plate starts to go, well, Dan's there to get it for me, or Ivan's there to shake it, you know. If, you know, and if Dan's over there and he can't get this one, Harold will get this one, you know? What makes me laugh? I don't know. I just don't know. That's the deal, is you just keep looking for what makes you laugh. I mean, if I knew, then I'd always be funny, you know? I mean, I'd always be laughing, but I'm not always laughing and I'm not always funny. And that's what I guess gets you out of bed in the morning is what's going to be funny today. I mean, when I got to work anyway. I mean, what's going to interest me today? You know, what's interesting? And what's interesting is, you know, the surprise and that when you find out you don't know everything. What makes you laugh is you're expecting something and you get something else, and that's a surprise and it's a learning thing. So what makes me laugh is new information, I guess, that changes the way I thought about things.
Originally, you know, I mean, I thought these characters were very, you know, rich and full of possibilities. So I always knew that there was more than one story. Even when writing the first one, I was thinking of, well, if they do this, they could do this, this, and this. And so basically, what we did was just try to take the first movie as a base, and since all the characters were established, we really didn't have to go into the building character. We were able to take it as a springboard and move on to kind of a different story and different set of concerns. Harold and I don't really have a Second City history formally, except separately. We didn't really work together, but we talk in shorthand. We understand each other, you know, and he's really a great collaborator, you know. This is a nice man. This is not some mad, you know, rageaholic, you know, who's going to sit there and say, no, no, that's not going to work. No, you know, which is what you get sometimes with a lot of writers. And it's a very easy process, I guess, because although we didn't actually work together on stage, we understand improvisation and we understand the techniques of Second City and the idea of developing a story from nothing. So, kind of like we're from the same college, if you will. We got a degree from the same school, if you will, but in different years.
There was this feeling, we'd never done a sequel, none of us had ever done a sequel, although we'd had offers on virtually every film we'd worked on. Because we thought it was bad luck, we thought it was crass, and we thought, why do it? You know, you've done something great, let the legend, you know, remain. We can only screw it up if we try it again. But then we started thinking, well, if we could come up with a concept that seemed worthy, that really progressed us in some way, that had something new to say, then we could, let's do it. So we started talking. I had some notions, Dan had some ideas. We played with many different permutations of what happened to the Ghostbusters after the first movie. And we finally settled on something that would seem meaningful for all of us, and that's what we pursued. I used to say that someone asked me if I was the class clown. I said I wasn't, but I used to write for the class clown. And that sort of was true. I would instigate practical jokes or suggest things. I would say something quietly, which the someone else would then repeat louder and get the laugh, you know, and I thought, well, gee, you know, he got the laugh, I wrote the line, you know. So, but there's something to be said for both roles. I think it came out of the, I grew up absurdist, you know. They say comedians are born from an absurd paradox they can't reconcile as children. You think, well, gee, the world is insane. So you have a choice. You can either think you're insane or the world's insane. If you make the decision that the world's insane, then from then on, everything seems absurd. And I think I grew up in absurd times, you know, growing up I was a teenager in the 50s and in college in the early 60s, and I was just the perfect age when the Haight-Ashbury happened in the late 60s, and just saw a lot of stuff, and it all seemed goofy to me. I sort of made a commitment to satire, to sort of taking a real and as intelligent a look as I could as what was going on, and with a lot of roots in the Marx Brothers, you know, trying to be
as broad as the Marx Brothers, but as satirical and intelligent as I could be within that.
You hope it's not really slimy, and it is slimy. And after a while, it sort of gels over the skin in a weird way, and it gets in your hair, and it's, because we went swimming in it, you can't really just put a little glob on and let that do. You really have to be drenched in this stuff. The first time we did it for two nights, and the first night, I got the chills like you wouldn't believe, and it was really, for me, very painful. The second night, maybe because I knew what to expect, it really wasn't as bad. We had tents set up, and it was just a little better situation. And then you start to enjoy it. It's almost like you commit to it. I think maybe that was it. The first night, I hadn't really committed. It's like, oh, you resist. Maybe that's the way it is with everything. You resist to a certain point, then you say, okay, I'm a part, I'm there. Yeah, I think probably if I think of the 20 or so years that I've been working as an actor and making a living as an actor, I really feel blessed to be a part of a project that people really genuinely identify with and like. It's not a violent film. It's a film that I think gives back. I think people come away with something. Certainly kids do. I'm amazed at how long it's been popular. I mean, normally you do a film and it's out for 6 months if you're lucky, and people are still talking about it, and then it's gone. And it's been 5 years since we did the first one, and it's still very popular. And so I really feel blessed. I can't think of another term or word. I think it's to be the character, and in a small way, being able to give, because I think as actors, we do want to give back something. We do, it's our offering. And so this is a project that I can contribute something in.
You know, I never went to a co-ed school, so to me it's like being put in a class with the most awful boys who spend all their time throwing spitballs and dipping your braids into the inkwell. You know, it's this sort of streak of masochism in me. I mean, I love them all, but it really is like boys town. And I just find it wonderful. I think each of those guys is so talented in a very different way from anyone else. And the way they work together is so generous and so appreciative of each other. I think that whole Second City generosity of, you know, making sure the other person has the best moment is something I think all sort of what I call straight actors like myself, we should all get to visit that world, because it involves a lot of the same principles, but it's just lots of fun, you know. But I mean, it would be interesting someday to work with Bill where I do play a funny person. Of course, I'd want Harold to write it. But I don't think it'll ever happen. It's actually really nice to be the Margaret Dumont of this particular group. I feel actually that it's a great honor and privilege. I feel they are our sort of Marx Brothers. And I think the films really hold up.
It's very much like coming back to family. I'm walking around here saying, let's do a series, you know. Thursday nights at 9:30, Ghostbusters. What, you know, this is it. It depends. I've encountered all kinds of people. For the most part, when people come up to me, it's Lewis Tully from Ghostbusters that they remember, and they don't really know my name. They just point at me and go, Ghostbusters, and I go, yes. Sometimes people will remember me from something I did on SCTV or Mackenzie Brothers. And once in a while, a really pathetic looking person will come up to me. Just when I'm at the point where I'm positive that they're going to stab me or mug me, they remind me of Streets of Fire, which was a picture that I did several years ago for Walter Hill. I don't know. I get asked that a lot about what is it about Canadians that makes them funny. There are per capita a higher number of Canadians than Americans working in comedy. There just seem to be a lot of Canadians. Ivan's Canadian and I'm Canadian. Eugene, who's here for a day, is Canadian. And Harold isn't Canadian, but we like him to be. Danny's Canadian. Bill is just across the lake, Chicago, from Canada. I don't know. Do you have any theories? Does anybody have any good theories about why Canadians are funny? Lewis is very much like a little kid. And my feeling after the first film, as a fan of the film, was that I wanted to be a Ghostbuster. And then here we are 5 years later, and we're on the streets of New York shooting, and little kids are coming, and they're wearing their backpacks and holding their little ectomobiles, and I think every one of those kids, like Lewis, wants to be a Ghostbuster. So when we were developing the script, I said to Ivan, there's one thing I want to do, which is I want to put on the equipment and try and be a Ghostbuster, because I think kids would relate to that. So there's a little bit of that in this film. I don't quite make it, but maybe in the third Ghostbusters, I'll actually get to catch a ghost or something.
I mean, that everybody's back, the whole original cast, I think it's unbelievable. I mean, the sequels never get the whole original cast back, I don't think. And yes, it has been. I mean, it's been nice for everybody to come back and know that. I mean, the comfortable feeling is it's not like we're working in the dark here. Everybody knows what they've got on it, everybody on every level. So it's very comfortable atmosphere. Harold and Danny wrote this very funny character, and they wrote her very well, so I don't feel like I need to go off or anything. I mean, occasionally there'll be, you know, a little twist here or there, and that's fine, but I was trained in the theater, and we did classic plays, and nobody went in and said, you know, Mr. Ibsen's line here, I don't know, I think it would be better. What do you think if we said, you know, I mean, no, even Neil Simon, it's like I'm not going to say that line. I'd rather say, I mean, so you don't touch it. So I came in with that background. The first time I worked on a film, and I was standing talking to the director, and another actor came up who'd been around obviously longer than I had, which was about 2 days. He said, I don't want to say this line. I think maybe I was thinking about my character last night, and I want to say, and I thought, who do you think you are? You want to change the line? I mean, I was just trying to be a soldier and, you know, do it.
For a director, the tough part here is to recapture the electricity that came about from the first one. I'm happy to say that the job has been made easier for me because of the excellence of the performers. I mean, there is something that happens when you put these guys together in a room. They're individually wonderful actors and comedians, and somehow when they work together, they're even greater than the sum of the parts. So that's already a great step forward for me. If I ever feel that the material is not quite right, we seem to be able to work it out so that it will work out in the end. Quite a lot of things trigger humor in me. I'm a pretty cheap laugh. Bill always kids me on what an easy laugh I am. Our sound man is always in despair because I'm forever laughing during a take. But I find, I don't know when I started doing that, and I've never stop to worry about laughing during a take. I try to control myself in terms of the amount of sound I make, but I feel that the actors feel it, that at some point they have to focus on somebody. They have to get an energy, and comedy is such an ephemeral thing that that the energy that comes back is important to them. So I give it. And it's not a phony thing, I absolutely respond. And when I don't respond, I know we don't have it. And so I just keep pounding them and keep reworking the scene, changing the lines or the blocking or whatever it takes to try to get that shiver in my back. Because when I get that, I get a, you know, at least I develop a confidence in the scene. It It's obviously a producer's dream for a film to play cross-section of all audiences as much as possible, because obviously if it's going to do that, it will be successful and a lot of money is made. As a director, it's an extraordinary thrill because it means that somehow, in the process of the storytelling, I'm communicating to a very broad audience. And, you know, people talk about family films, about films like the old days in the 40s. Why don't people make films that cut across all audience barriers and give us the thrill of those films? And when it does happen, when you happen to make a film that for whatever reason that magic occurs, it's an extraordinary thrill, to creative thrill, because it means that somehow the story is translating, that it's universal. And it's not only in America, it's universal across the world.
Oh, that's fine. It's fine to get the baby up. Let me have one.
I had to hold the baby up.
Excuse me. Said Ghostbusters right on the thing.
Hey guys, I brought it.
So just say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's even longer. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right. So it's even shorter. It's 1 feet 6.
So I'm 6. You said save it or give it up. Whatever.
I said 8. Says no. It's even longer.
6, 7.
Yeah. 6, 7.
Okay. Do this move together. Ready, guys? And action.